Hey everyone, happy March. I know it's been a while since you've had an episode from me, but guys, forgive me. I was really sick in February. I had a cold for like 2 weeks, then my daughter got sick, and then I am just one of those people that I get bronchitis chronically. So I was down with bronchitis for 2 weeks. So that pretty much just killed February. But guys, I am back and I have an amazing lineup of guests to finish out season three for the podcast. So welcome to another episode of the Caregiving and Entrepreneurship Reimagined podcast. If this is your first time here, welcome. My name's Melissa Miller. I'm a former a certified nursing assistant turned full-time stay-at-home mother and spousal caregiver 4 years ago for my husband. And now I'm passionate about helping busy entrepreneurs like yourself learn simple, stress-free systems to help you in the role of being a caregiver, because obviously not everyone has 15 years of medical experience like I have as a CNA. And I'm passionate about helping you navigate this journey with the experts I have on this episode, on this podcast, and with my experiences. And today we're going to be focusing kind of more on the topic of self-care. And the expert I have today, she's amazing, y'all. She is amazing. I have Sarah with me. Sarah, thank you for being on the podcast.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
Yes. So, Sarah, for those of you who are not, or for those of my listeners who are maybe not acquainted with your work or don't even know who the heck you are, can you share a little bit about who you are, what you got in, why you got into the role in entrepreneurial-wise that you did, and we'll just take it from there.
Absolutely. So I am an astrology coach and a healer. I merge astrology with holistic healing and life coaching to help people who are navigating big life transitions in their, at this moment, and to help them find self-empowerment and live a life of joy and abundance. So I was a teacher for 14 years. I taught French and Spanish in China as well for 7 years. And I just started to feel with teaching, I love teaching, but I was feeling called to help people in a deeper way. So my final year of teaching was when I made the decision to just jump in without a life jacket into entrepreneur life, started a business in Shanghai. And as a healer, that's when I got my certifications in life coaching, in NLP, in astrology, and various modalities of healing along the way. And and here I am. That's kind of the
Yeah.
Cliff Notes version.
Oh, I love that. Well, and I think it's interesting that you spent some time in Asia because I was actually internationally adopted as an infant from South Korea. So there you go,
Wow.
another little connection there.
Thank you.
So I love that you're an alternative healing. And I know some people are uncomfortable about this, but you know what? I know personally from dealing with chronic illness of hypothyroidism and IBS, and then my own family members dealing with some other crazy health issues. Sometimes, as well-meaning as Western medicine is, sometimes it does more harm than good. Like it might help stabilize, quote unquote, the illness, but the side effects from treatments, be it a procedure or medications, it can really harm your body and put your body through the wringer in a whole nother way that's horrible. So I really want people to listen with an open mind that what we're going to talk about focusing about how you use astrology from your standpoint. For me, obviously, I'm a Christian. I will not be ashamed of that. And so my faith is my spirituality. But the commonality of what Sarah and I discussed when we did our planning call, guys, is that there's whatever faith you have, that we all have this need with to centralize I can't talk, our nervous system, guys. Not enough caffeine yet, guys, sorry. Our nervous system, because as an entrepreneur and especially as a caregiver, we are under so much extra stress than the average person. And like I've said before, if you don't take care of your mind, your body, and your soul from day one and every day through your journey as a business owner or as a caregiver, it's a house of cards. You're no good to the loved one that you're caring for. You're no good to the clients that you're trying to serve. And you're certainly no good to yourself because you're not having the quality of life. Because obviously, as caregivers, we are trying to give the best quality of life for our loved one amid their health challenges. And then as a business owner, we're obviously trying to instill the best possible quality of life by helping them with whatever pain point our businesses are targeted towards. So self-care, nervous system regulation is huge. So with that being said, what are some natural ways, Sarah, that you would, if someone were to come to you, if I were coming to you today and I was explaining my history of caring 2 years for my dad until he passed away, caring 2 years for my grandmother until she passed away, caring the last four for my husband with a chronic illness, and then on top of that, dealing with my own health and being a mom and trying to build a business, obviously you would be able to obviously read right away that I've burnt the candle at both ends. So what, from your perspective, are some natural ways you could help me?
Yeah. So I have a lot of experience this in experience with this in real time, because I am also the caregiver for my mother, who is 88 at this moment, and have been doing that for the past year and a half while building my own business. So the first most important piece, I would say, is making sure that you yourself have support throughout the journey, because being a caregiver, there's so much that comes up, not just in terms of being the emotional support person, right? And also, you know, it can be really hard, if especially if you have a loved one who is going through an illness, or, you know, and just seeing them going through that, especially if it's the final stage of life. So it's really important to make sure that you have support, and also to hold space for yourself without judgment in terms of all of the potential emotions that can and do come up during this process, because it is a process. When you are willing to, it's not something that everybody is actually honestly able to do, to be a caregiver, not especially in today's society. There's a lot of trauma. It's a lot of trauma in regards to family, generational trauma, but it's such a potent opportunity for healing, both for your, you know, if it's your parent, for your parent, and for yourself, to do this, because it's this type of role reversal where you are now the one who is caring for them, whereas they were the one who was caring for you as a child. So holding space for yourself and for whatever emotions are coming up during the period is one of the most important tips that I would give, because it's, you know, I have had everything from anger at times to resentment, you know, to guilt, to sadness. You will experience the whole spectrum of things, and there is nothing, the most important thing when it comes to emotions are just energy in motion, is holding space, not trying to, you know, without judgment. And when you're able to do that, it is a very healthy way of allowing yourself to move through this process. That, and also I always go with in the space of, what am I meant to learn through this? How is my parent, for example, my teacher? How is this process helping me to grow, helping my soul grow and to evolve? So those are some, it's like a perspective shift, so that you won't feel, because I feel like at times when we're the caregiver, and especially when we have those stresses of entrepreneur life, which is a whole other ball, a can of worms, right? Especially if you're doing this and you're starting from, if you don't have previous experience with business, you have to just give yourself grace for the learning curve that exists without judgment. So that's the thing that I always come back to, is this piece of holding space for yourself without judgment and getting the support when you need it. I think that's super important. I've worked myself with a spiritual mentor over the past year, and it has been incredible for me in this healing journey. And I've come to the space now of really being grateful for this experience. At the beginning, I wasn't. I was like, oh, yeah, why am I in this? You know, but I'm in the space now of, I'm really grateful that I've had this time to be with my mother, to go through the healing myself, to help her in terms of healing with her, within her own journey. So those are a couple of the just things that come to mind.
I love that. Well, and I like that you really focused on emotions there for a minute, because guys, we're human beings in human bodies, okay? And we were born with emotions, and it's normal for us to feel these emotions, okay? I want to emphasize that. It's okay to be angry at sometimes. It's okay to be sad. It's okay to be even frustrated, especially as a caregiver. You will get frustrated because there's moments where you'll be frustrated because you can't get the right insurance, or you're trying to struggle to pay for medications and insurance won't cover it. You'll be frustrated because the doctor has a perspective of what they think is best, but you feel like you're banging your head against the wall saying, no, my loved one does not want this, or we have tried something similar and we do not feel comfortable with this option because of previous awful experiences. You will feel frustrated because you do feel alone because you're the one on the front lines doing everything, helping with ADL care, helping with being their emotional support, like what Sarah was saying. You will get frustrated. Now, with that being said, like I said, it's okay to feel those emotions. The problem is when you don't release them in a healthy way, and it's like a pressure cooker. It just builds and builds, and then it explodes in an unhealthy way. So maybe it might be outbursting at your loved one or somebody else in your family. Maybe it's a health-related issue, burnout. That's ultimately what happened to me, is I put my health on the back burner the first year, and then in year two and three, I paid for it because I was not. It took a while for me. It took me a year to get diagnosed with IBS, and then by year two, okay, we knew what was going on now, but the road to healing and figuring out ways to get my illness under control took a lot longer than probably if I had been intentional with taking care of myself physically, with the body, and making sure that I was getting the help and support that I needed. So emotionally, I felt good in terms of having, a Christian life coach, and I had my pastors in my back pocket, and my family was super supportive. Even if they couldn't help logistically with the caregiving because of their own health issues or their lives, being able to know that they were just a text and a call away if I had a hard moment, that was helpful. So you will feel these emotions, and it's safe for you to feel these. And I want you to give yourself compassion. Compassion. To be okay with feeling these emotions, and then also being open to seeking help and support. Because like Sarah said, you cannot do this journey alone. I know after my experience, both professionally and personally, guys, as a caregiver, you cannot do this alone. It takes a village. I know we say that for raising kids, but it does take a village or a community, or what I call it, a support network. You need your support network. So I want you thinking about, as we're thinking to help you centralize your nervous system, where are you the weakest? Is it your mind? Is it your body? Is it your soul? And what can you do to make sure you're getting that part of the tripod, if you will, back up straight, so that way it's holding you, so you're coping again and you're preventing the pressure cooker scenario. So Sarah, with that being the case, let's break that down a little bit. So we've talked about the importance of having support. So let's break it down by mind, body, and soul. So if I were coming to you and I was saying that I was mentally, my mind, I was just feeling like I can't take this anymore. This is too much. I feel like I can't function. What would be some tips that you would recommend?
So yeah, if you had, that's a great question. If you came to me and that was what you said, the first thing I would look at would be actually giving you some practices for soothing the nervous system, because trauma gets stored, and we all have trauma from when we were, age 0 to 7. There's big T and there's a little T trauma, but it gets stored in the tissues. So, mindset work is important, but if you're not also doing the work again to connect with whatever is coming up and holding space for the emotions, then it's going to be more challenging to get the trauma to just, move through and to release it. So I would say the first thing that I would give is some practices for regulating your nervous system. And there are so many different ways that you can do this. Breath work is a technique. There are doing things like giving yourself space during the day to maybe go and take a walk in nature, to actually get out of the environment, because the energy of your environment also is going to have an effect on you and your energy. So giving yourself permission to just separate yourself maybe from the situation that's causing you a lot of stress and take a couple of hours off. You know, this is why I also think it's really important when you're a caregiver to make sure when we talk about the support, it's not just having the support for you, it's also having that physical support in place. For example, with my mother, there is somebody who takes her out for walks 2 to 3 times a week. You know, there she has somebody who takes her to the doctor's appointment so that I'm not in charge of all of that because it would be very difficult for me to really have all of my energy focused on my business if I'm constantly having to think about all of this. So I would say immediately, what can we look at in your physical environment? You know, I know we're talking about mindset, but also what can we look at in your physical environment that's going to help you to give you support so that you're not energetically feeling completely drained? Because then you're feeling drained, you're feeling overwhelmed, and then you don't want your nervous system to get to the point that it's just red alert, can't take this, we're going to shut down. So that would be the first step. That also, when it comes to the mindset work, I think a really powerful tool is something like journaling to actually get the thoughts out. You want to make sure that you're finding a way, a healthy way, again, to get those emotions out. So for some people, it can be journaling. For some people, when you get really angry, it can be really effective to go and punch a pillow, honestly, to just go and scream, you know, someplace where somebody
Absolutely.
can't hear you and just, you know, get it out. And that,
Yes.
yeah. And so that is, it's one of the things that will help you so that you get to this point with your nervous system that when you get triggered, you will respond instead of react. So you'll respond, you'll be able to have some detachment from the situation instead of maybe just lashing out because you get really upset. So those are some techniques right away that I would say could be helpful in terms of, you know, bringing you back to presence. Because it's also about with the mind, when we're going into that state of panic, you're either focused on the future and anxious about, you know, what could potentially happen, or you're in the past. Whereas if we can do these mindfulness practices to get you into the present moment, and that's why I say going out into nature, even if it's just for 10 minutes, is a beautiful way to bring you into presence, into also gratitude, anything that involves a gratitude practice, you know, finding gratitude for the here and now brings you back to, okay, you know, to the state of being in the now, in the present moment. And that is going to help you in terms of regulating your nervous system because it's going to help to reduce the anxiety because you're not focused on the what if and this could be happening and going into the hypervigilance mode. Honestly, if you go outside and do a 5-minute gratitude practice, connect with the birds, connect with the sun, the feeling of the sun, you know, on your, you know, tune into your senses. This is a really powerful technique as well. You know, sitting, being present, closing your eyes, going outside and saying, okay, how am I feeling? What am I feeling right now? Maybe you're feeling the warmth of the sun on your body. Okay, what am I smelling? Maybe you have the smells of the dew because it's first thing in the morning. What am I hearing? Tuning into the sounds maybe of the birds chirping, of the squirrels. Tuning into your senses is a super powerful way to calm things, to regulate, to come into, again, I keep talking about presence, but that's the one of the most powerful parts of this is coming back into the present moment, being in the here and now with acceptance, you know, without judgment, just this is where I am with it, and with this element of detachment. That's the piece that I think we want to get to. It's not necessarily easy because we're human, but that's a big part of it.
Yeah. Wow, you just okay, we got to unpack some of this because this you had some good bombs there, girl. I love it. Okay, so
Thank you.
physical support. I will say I want to break this down. So in the medical world, we call it respite. Respite is so important for you. And like Sarah said, whether it's an hour, a couple hours, or even a day, I want you thinking about how you can get some respite if you are feeling like it's too much. As the caregiver, you're the one doing the primary cares and the primary care and doing all the ADLs. And for those of you not in the medical world, ADLs are activities of daily living. So those are the basic things like dressing, mobility, bathing, eating. Okay. And if you're physically doing all that and it is too much, or even just being on call just in case something happens, or you have to watch them, like if you're dealing with someone that's a flight risk or something, there's so many different illnesses and so many different situations. So depending on where you're at, I want you thinking about what makes sense. If they're bedridden and they need 24/7 care, like turning, repositioning, they don't get up and go to the bathroom, so you're changing adult depends. a 5 to 7 day respite in a long-term care facility might be the best thing for you. And I know personally from experience, when my dad was on hospice, the hospice agency partnered locally with a specific long-term care facility. So all I had to do, I never used it, but if I did, I would just have to make a call and say, okay, I need a break. And they would start working the phones and arrange transportation and everything for me to take dad into a long-term care facility for 5 to 7 days or whatever it was that they would allow and insurance would allow so I could have a break. And long-term care facilities are great because unlike it's different than a hospital. Hospitals are more for like triage. Long-term care is like 24-hour care. So that means there's nurse licensed nurses, a doctor on call, CNAs that they're there 24/7 looking after your loved one. And I know it's kind of tough because there's all those horror stories, but guys, I had a lot of respite patients. A lot of respite patients I had, not all were long-term. I had respites all the time. And that's okay. So if you need to do that, that's a good option. Another option would be if you aren't to the point where you need maybe a long-term care facility, but maybe if it is for breaks, home health is a gold mine. I worked for a home health agency for a year and a half, and they can help with light cooking, light errands, housekeeping, meal prep. I had patients where all I would be there, I had times where I had would have a patient where I was only there for an hour and a half shift, and it was just to make sure that she took her medication at correctly, safely, and just to be there until her family came back from whatever they were doing in that time of day. And I would do that maybe 2 or 3 times a week, I think, if I remember it, something like that. So, but I was there for making sure she got her meds, making sure she got through her meal, and just being there an adult on site in case something happened. So if you're needing, it depends on what your insurance will do and what the facility and what the hospice, or not hospice, excuse me, guys, the home health agency will offer. Maybe you could do a window 2 or 3 times a week of where you were just strictly asking an aide to come and sit with your loved one for an X amount of time so you can have a break. Okay, and then that maybe that could be your window where you do plan some fun me time, or maybe it is that medical appointment so you don't have to freak out of going, okay, I'm trying to take care of myself going to the doctor, but I don't want to leave mom by herself, or I don't feel comfortable leaving my husband by himself. That could be a great asset for you. And maybe they could do some of their task list could be light housework, you know, or a meal prep, or making sure your loved one gets through their meal. Maybe you prep it, but you just tell them, but you're there to, you have them there just to make sure that just for safety, like if they have issues with swallowing or choking, someone's there to supervise to make sure they don't choke on their food. Or family or friends, that's another one. Obviously, every family's different. I know personally for me, my family's had a lot of various health challenges and other things going on. So I really try to be respectful of that and not ask them for a ton of assistance. I really try to do most of it. But maybe you have family or friends, or maybe your congregation of faith and your faith in your congregation of faith, your church, synagogue, whatever, that could maybe be willing to partner with you and come and do a day or two every week. So start making those phone calls. And start doing your research for what is available in your local area. I wish I could say that, oh yeah, if you just do XYZ, you'll get the same result. But things vary from state to state, things vary from family to family and what your loved one's health issue is. But in terms of respite, that is so important. Then the other thing I want to just touch on real quick that Sarah talked about, nature. It is the best thing to get out of that environment. I love what you said. I mean, I do it mainly for just getting that movement, you know, for exercise. The physical health aspect is kind of what I teach and I've told you guys. But I love what Sarah talked about, how you're removing yourself from the environment. And I now that I think about it, because I go on 30-minute walks with my daughter. We love going outside for walks when the weather permits. But that is so true. I do notice, man, when I'm outside in God's great creation and I'm just taking in the sights, the smells, and the sounds. It's so fun, and especially with my daughter, seeing it from her perspective, because she loves me outside, like, Mommy, there's a plane, or Mommy, look at that pretty tree, or Mom, there's a bird. It gives you a break, and it gets you off all the stress and everything that's going on in the home for even if it's just 15 minutes, like Sarah said, 10 to 15 minutes or 30 minutes, whatever works for you. I just want you to do it. Or even maybe it's going outside, maybe a timeout. Maybe you can't maybe do that much time outside. But maybe you can do 5-minute breaks where if you're feeling like, Okay, I feel like I'm about to blow my stack. Okay, pardon me. I need to go outside for 5 minutes. I got my timer set, so when the timer goes off, I promise I will be back. There's so many different things you can do for getting in some time. Journaling is another good one. I personally love to journal, and especially being a Christian, I love with my Bible time. The best way I know for me when I'm reading my Bible is actually doing more reflection journaling with, so, and I love like Bible studies that do that, where there's a lot of journaling and inner work, kind of like that. So if that's you, maybe this is a time to do that, to reconnect with your faith if it's fallen by the wayside, because that can give you some peace and help regulate your nervous system as well. And also, it also might get you in contact with some other emotional and spiritual support if you're doing it alongside a program within your congregation of faith or something, or maybe something even online with a buddy, just one-on-one online. Like maybe once a week you have a 15-minute Zoom call or text or something about what you're getting like from reading a book or doing a study of some sort. It is so important that you give yourself different outlets because they're all intertwined. Whether you're journaling, whether you're outside, whether you're just asking for help, it's all centered mind, soul, body. You know, making that call to have someone take care of your loved one for a week, that's taking the stress off your mind so you don't have to worry about if they're going to be okay. That's giving your soul the peace of mind that, look, I'm still doing what I feel was I was called to do, to be my loved one's primary caregiver, but it's okay for me to take a break. And it's giving you mind, and then it's giving your physical body a chance to just rest, just maybe get some extra sleep, to have real slow down and actually get have some time to actually enjoy your meals and not be in a rush because you have to go take care of your loved one. It's all intertwined and it all matters. Okay, that's what we're trying to get at. And it's okay if you take different aspects of what Sarah and I are telling you and tweaking it into a way that works for you. That's the beautiful thing here. This isn't a, oh, you have to do it X, Y, and Z. It's no. We're telling you what we see from our own experiences that could be a problem, and we're trying to give you some tools to not to prevent the hardships and mistakes and burnout that we may have experienced. But we want you to do it in a way that works for you and makes sense to you. Wouldn't you agree, Sarah?
Yeah, absolutely. And I would add too, there can be a tendency when you're going through overwhelm, when stress to isolate yourself. And it's actually super important that you do the opposite, that you actively get yourself out. That's why I say, getting actually physically getting out of the environment. And there are different ways that you can do this and through seeking support. But also the other part that I would just add as well, I had a conversation with my mom at the beginning because you want to also set some healthy boundaries. If you're giving yourself energetically 100% all of the time as in the role of a caregiver, your cup is going to be depleted. And if your cup is depleted, you're not going to have the energy that you need to actually be able to show up in a way that really honors you and that honors the other person. So there was a point where I had a conversation with my mom, and I said to her, we need to have some support. So how do you want, what does this look like? What are you comfortable with? Should we get a home health aide, somebody who is going to come a couple of times a week? She didn't really, my father had a home health aide because he had debilitating arthritis and somebody who was actually living in the house. My mom really was not happy with that idea. And the compromise that we found was a friend she had who actually works with people who are older and who takes her out, a couple of times a week, takes her out for walks. And this is somebody that she likes already, that she knows, that she trusts, that she has a relationship with. And this takes some of the strain off of me. Additionally, I've gone on trips to Europe because that's my happy place. And so when I've gone, there's another friend of hers who stays in the house. She pays her, but this again, she has a relationship. She feels very comfortable with her. So, I think it's really important to have that communication as well with if it's your parent, whoever it is that you are providing the care for, so that they understand, that you it's mutually, the energy needs to be balanced. You're supporting them, but you also need to make sure you have that support in place for yourself.
Yeah, and I love that as a caregiver, you are the ultimate advocate for your loved one. If and you're that first line of defense, y'all. If they don't feel comfortable with something, you're supposed, they're the first one that says, no, my loved one doesn't want this. And that's why it's so important to have those conversations. I agree so hard, wholeheartedly with Sarah about what she's saying here. This is good stuff. And again, seasons change. So maybe right now they don't feel comfortable with X, Y, and Z, but maybe they are later on. So just so as you as the caregiver, be open and just keep learning. There's always stuff like really up there, you know, about like what the latest trend is for caregiving or healthcare. There's all the medical field is always changing, guys. Healthcare is always changing. So there's always new things. Some things are awesome and we're like, okay, we're on for this. Others are like, no, we're ditching that. I'm not even interested. I'm not going to pursue that. So, and even maybe locally, maybe there's things locally where you live, there's more resources that you could tap into. So, whether it's a new support caregiver support group at your local community center or at a or at a place of faith, maybe you could start doing that. Maybe it's getting to the point where you do need to look at more having someone. I've even heard of people who actually they have family or friends that move in. That's all what the situation was with my grandma is I moved in with her 2 years prior to her life, mainly, and I paid her, I treated her like a landlord, but it also worked out to be a good fit for when she did start to decline. I could see things. And so then we started having family meetings and we came up with a system for how we took care of grandma with having her in our homes. And we would have a calendar with dates of who took her when, and we'd have a notebook so we could write down notes for her hospice and her home health and then hospice team to know what was going on. And then between ourselves, we had a group chat, which to this day, even though Gran's gone, but we've had held on to that family group chat through losing my mom 2 years ago, losing my dad just this past year when my husband started getting sick 4 years ago. I mean, it has really served us to have that line of communication. And you could do the same thing with your healthcare team. Maybe it's having a Google sheet. And just having different tabs of information and doing a chart. And then there, whether it's on your phone or your computer, there is a send button that will send a PDF. So then maybe you could just send that to your medical team. Because what happens whenever a ER visit happens or a trip to the ER happens, stuff gets sent does get sent, excuse me, from those facilities to your follow-up doctor because you always have a follow-up appointment afterwards. But that's just a fraction of it. That's what the hospital or medical staff are seeing. What did you see? You know their baseline, you know their highs and lows of their illness, their triggers, their symptoms, their good days and bad days. You know them better than anybody. And so you as the caregiver with that open line of communication, sometimes it's not just saying it, but writing it down and documenting it somewhere and sending it to other people, whether it's hospice, home health, a long-term care facility, you know, your medical team, that opens up the line of communication too about what is working, what's not working, and what might need to be done. And that's really what gets you those referrals for the benefits of like home health and hospice too, even. So it's to die to be able to say that this is an appropriate step for you. Because I know with my dad, he had been on home health for quite a while there up until his last hospitalization within the last year of his life. But the last one, he had when he entered the hospital in that moment, he was entering where he was below his baseline of where he was 6 weeks prior. And the staff initially were going to write it off and send him home with home health. And the home health team were like, no, they had a meeting behind my back, and it was in a good way where they said, that doesn't make sense. He's not even where he was 6 weeks ago. And the amount and with where he's at, he doesn't have even the strength to do all the quota that we would of work that we would need him to do to retain home health. And then he'd lose the service. So they said, no, let's switch him up. Let's up the ante and move him over, get him discharged with orders for hospice. It doesn't mean that he's going to go right away. Hospice, getting a hospice order doesn't mean that they're going to go like within 6 months for sure, or you know, or something like that. But it does take the load off to where dad could rest, and it's more palliative care, whereas he gets to choose how much he can do or not do, and that takes the load off you as the healthcare worker. And obviously, Home health has many services, guys, but hospice has a lot more. And I am so thankful that for that, because dad actually passed away a week later when he was discharged from the hospital. So it was incredibly fast. We thought we had more time, but at the same time, thank God that our team caught on to that, because I would have been rushing. I would have been really trying to work the phones and scrambling to get a hospital bed for him and a commode and all these other pieces of medical equipment that I did not have on site at our house. And with how fast he declined, it would have been more stress, more paperwork, more phone calls that I did not need in that moment. So depending on where you're at with your, depending where you're at in your caregiving journey, it's really important to have those conversations too of like, what do you think, where are we at? You know, do we need to up the ante on some resources right now? Because, you know, would it be a better use of our time to do to implement things now just in case? Or are we good? It's okay to have those conversations. And in my case with my father, it was the best conversation that we had. And we still gave dad control. I mean, I had a conversation at home with our hospice team, and I was our home health team initially. And I was totally on board with what they had. But I was, but ultimately, though, too, we wanted what dad wants. So he ultimately got to decide, do you want to, you know, are you okay with hospice, with us transitioning you to hospice care versus home health because of where you're at? And the home health, or excuse me, the hospice team was so great. They came and had a one-on-one conversation with just me, daddy, and them. And it was for like an hour and a half. And they took their time. They just sat and kept talking and answering questions that daddy had. And ultimately, daddy consented. And it was the best choice that we did. It was the best choice that we could have ever done. So it doesn't always go that way, but it still, whatever the situation is, whatever the resources that you need, maybe for this season you might need it. And you can always come off. There, I've had people that have gone off hospice because they did improve and they transitioned back to home health. So just know that about the systems too, is that you might go for one thing, but it doesn't mean that it's a, you know, set in stone forever type situation. You can pull back. So maybe they do, maybe your loved one declines and hospice looks like the better resource to get you some more resources of support. You know, okay, let's go that way. But oh, they do better. Okay, we'll transition them back to home health, because they do have assessments, you know, for how long they have to before they're to qualify for whatever services they get. And that's okay. That's okay. So be open, be compassionate, and just give yourself some grace. Okay. This caregiving role is tough. It's tough physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. You will run the gamut through this journey, I promise you. But that doesn't mean that you have to go through this journey alone, unprepared, and without resources and help and tools. And that's what Sarah and I are really passionate about trying to help you with this conversation, with giving you some tools and some information and just helping you get started somewhere, wherever you're at, to be able to leave after listening to this call, be able to go, okay, I have some other ideas of what I can do for myself in terms of self-care. And maybe in turn, and also maybe getting my loved ones some better support, or getting us both some support. So so ultimately, you're not burning out as the caregiver. And if you're an entrepreneur like us, you're having more time to be able to pursue your dream with your business too, okay? But also, you can have peace of mind knowing that your loved one's having the best quality of life. And if it's like Sarah, where she's dealing with what I called from, because I primarily worked in long-term care facilities with elderly dementia patients. So what I call it is twilight years. So if you're in a situation like Sarah's, where she's dealing with twilight years, or like what I just got finished doing with my up caring for my dad until he passed away in July, I want that to be the best quality of time for you and your loved one, where their needs are being met physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Same for you. You're not burning out. And whatever time you have left, it's good. And it's and the stress, the overwhelm, the fear is kept to a low roar. That's what we're going for here. So, Sarah, do you have anything to add to that before I have you blast where you're at, where people can find you and work with you?
I would just add, from my personal experience, I've been through this completely solo. I do not have a partner. I do not have kids. I moved back from China to Philadelphia, to a city where I have not lived for 16 years. I did not have a community. I did not have friends here. So I was really starting from zero while being full on in the caregiver role and the entrepreneur role. And I will say I definitely did at the beginning isolate myself and went down the black hole of depression, which I think a lot of people can do in this journey. And it really helped me to realize, first of all, getting support, and also just to realize that you really are not alone. You're never alone in the journey. You always, when you ask for support and you talk to the universe, to spirit, to whatever, however you connect with energy, I've always received it when I've asked for it in my life, so just remembering that, just remembering that, and that everything also is transitory. Like, this too shall pass. And so you want to also be in the moment. When I was speaking before about presence and coming back into the present moment, I was so in the future with the anxiety of what happens if my mother passes away tomorrow and what do I do and everything, that I wasn't actually enjoying this time, being present in the moment, to for this time, however long this time ends up being, that I have to spend with her. So I really feel like doing these the things that we talked about, the nervous system practices, for regulating your nervous system, making sure that you are also giving yourself care, not just being the caregiver, but also making sure that you are giving yourself the care that you need through this experience, is just going to make the transition so much easier. These are the things that I wish I had known, honestly, from the beginning.
Yeah. Well, and here's the thing. God, the universe, again, whatever you believe. For me, it's the Lord. You know what? Even though at my lowest, I will say too, there's times where, I was angry. It's like, why did this happen? Why do my parents have to be so overcome with so many illnesses? Why did my husband have to get sick so young just after we had a baby and went through 6 years of infertility? It feels unfair, but I just have to lean into the fact that, I'm not meant to know everything. We're not meant to have all the answers, and some things will be unfair. It doesn't mean that we're bad people. It just means that sometimes things happen that are out of our control, and we have a choice. We have a choice of how we deal with it and show up to it. And ultimately, that's the reason my business exists, is I just want to help. I have the blessing of 15 years in the healthcare industry, and I have the blessing of caring. I have had cared for two dear loved ones in my life, and that gave me a different perspective because both situations were different. I dealt with my elderly grandmother, and then I had my aging father, who was in his early 70s when he passed. So, and different health issues. So it, and while being a parent too and a business owner, so many hats. But I just want to say that you guys are doing the best you can. Okay. It's not an easy path, but it's the path of the chosen few. Some people do opt. Maybe the best option is that your loved one is in a long-term care facility 24/7 because you don't have the capacity to do all this work. And it's better, and your time is better served by just going in regularly for visits and and care plan meetings to with the facility staff to decide what they think of, or what you all collectively think as the caregiving team think is the best option for your loved one. That's okay too. Everyone's situation's different. There's no cookie cutter A, B, and C method that works for everybody across the board. You have to figure it out. But if you're feeling stuck and you're frustrated on how to get there, we're here for you. Okay. So, Sarah, where can we get more Sarah if people want to find you?
So you can find me on, I'm on social media. My Instagram is Sarah, SARAH, Soul, SOUL, Boss. That's also my website, Sarah Soul Boss. I have a free newsletter if you sign up that I publish twice a month, where I give strategies for navigating big transitions in your life. And so those are the main, Facebook, Sarah Boss. So those are the main ways to connect, and please do connect. And I would love to hear from, anybody about who's going through, a journey, or maybe seeking some support in terms of navigating all of this.
Awesome. So before we go, I have had so much fun asking this question with all my guests because there's been a whole gamut of interesting answers. So what is something that we've talked about either in our conversation today or maybe through your own business slash caregiving journey that has just really stuck with you that you would like to leave with our listeners as we close this episode out as a kind of encouragement, pep talk, and inspiration piece? So have at it, girl.
So amazing conversation. Thank you so much for this. And I would say for me, a really big one has been the power of acceptance and forgiveness, especially if, there are those of us who maybe have had a challenging relationship at times with, if it's a parent or who, if it's a sibling, whoever it is that we're caring for. And so I personally, in my journey, had to go through the gamut of emotions and healing on my own end before I could come to that space. But I did eventually come to the space of forgiveness and of acceptance in terms of, everything that I had been attached to with trauma that was also connected to my mother. And energetically, it just felt like a big weight had been lifted, and it improved significantly the relationship that I have with her. So it was that. And also, you just never know what's around the corner. The universe is so unpredictable. Things can change from one day to the next. That's why gratitude for, for the present moment. So those would be my two big takeaways.
Awesome. Well, Sarah, thank you for being a guest. This was such a treat to
Thank
get to
you.
have you on and to share your experience and your knowledge. And just, I really like what we talked about because, alternative ways to dealing with stress. I mean, we could go to our counselor, we could do medication, but, for some people, that is just going to add more trauma and chaos inwardly to our bodies. So I really want these conversations to be allowed where we talk about other alternative ways of in simple ways that we can regulate our nervous system, regulate our mind, our body, and our soul so we can cope. It's all I really want to emphasize, it's really about coping. How can you better cope in healthy ways to avoid that pressure cooker situation that we talked about at the beginning of this episode so you can show up for yourself, so you can show up for your loved one, and if you're a business owner like we are, show up for your clients and help change their lives. So, guys, thank you so much for tuning into this episode of the Caregiving and Entrepreneurship Reimagined podcast. Guys, I have an amazing new workshop going live on Zoom on Wednesday, March 27th at 10 a.m. Mountain Standard, noon Eastern. The link will be in the description box below, wherever you're watching this on Spotify, Apple, my YouTube channel, and then obviously on my website. All that information, along with Sarah's links, will be included below. And this workshop, I do want to emphasize too, is if you are feeling stuck about how to create some simple systems for managing all your loved one's medical history and getting a routine around your home for caring for a loved one without 15 years of medical experience like I have, girls, gotcha. This workshop is going to be so helpful with giving you some simple, stress-free tips to make caregiving easier for you. So you can go after your dreams in your online business. So guys, thanks for watching or listening, and I will see you in the next episode of the Caregiving and Entrepreneurship Reimagined podcast. Take care, guys.